So in this video presentation, we're continuing on the series of videos for learners new to the electrical department at Tresham College. Previously, Joe, we looked at...
We looked at the 10 tools, didn't we, that make up our basic toolkit. So that's been covered really nicely by Gaz. And today we're going to have a little bit of a chat about basic wiring accessories that a student can expect to use here at the college and also in their early working days out in the workplace.
And we're likely to be touching on these very soon after coming into college, after health and safety. Yep. So probably within the first 2 or 3 weeks, we'll be actually working with these accessories.
Yeah. So what have we got in front of us then, Gaz?
So Joe, we've got a one gang, one way switch here. Can you explain to me what that means?
Yeah, absolutely. This is a common switch. Most people will be familiar with this. You'll have seen it all over your home. But what we're going to do is we're just going to break down that expression you just said, Gaz. One gang, one way. So let's first of all just tackle the one gang part of it. What that means is you've got one switch in the middle of the plate by itself. A bit later on we'll look at a two gang switch and you'll see the difference there. But that's what we mean by one gang. Basically we mean one switch in the middle of the plate there. Now in order to address the one way part of the switch, we turn this around and look at the back. Now when we look at the back here, you can see that there's three holes in the back of the plate. One of these holes in a one-way switch is completely empty. It's blank. It doesn't have anything in there at all. The reason for that will become clear when we look at what a two-way switch is. We've got two terminals that actually have something in them, and this is where we would terminate our conductors coming into the accessory. The terminals are marked up common and one-way. You may also find on the back of a switch, this may be marked up as common and L1, means the same thing. And all we'd have here is two conductors, one going in the top, one going in the bottom, and the switch will then break that conductor. So what we can see there is we've got a one gang, one way switch.
So we've changed accessory, Joe, but it looks very similar to the one shown previously. What have we got this time?
So we've changed two things about the switch here, Gaz. What we've done is we've moved on from looking at perhaps a budget range switch where it was all very square and angular. And what we're looking at now is something that's a little bit more visually pleasing. So this is a Click switch. It's been manufactured by the company Click, and it's from their mode range. They very kindly donated lots of accessories to us here at Tresham College, so we thank them again for that very much. And when you look at this, you can see it's got more rounded corners. The switch is slightly curved on the front face there, which looks nicer. We've also got, that you can't see here, we've got inserts that go into over the screw covers to make those look quite nice as well. And if we turn it sideways on, you can see we've got a nice chamfer on the top and the bottom of the switch. So it's a more aesthetically pleasing switch. So that's the visual side of things, but when we start to look at the functional side of things, that's where we've changed even more. So looking at the front of the switch, you can see this is still a one gang switch because we've just got one switch in the middle of the plate there. But when we turn it around, we can see that something's changed. So what we've got on the back here indicates that this is a two-way switch. So we've got three terminals now, and all of those terminals have actually got connections inside them that we can make. So they're labeled up common up at the top. We've got L1 down at the bottom here, which would be the equivalent of the one-way terminal on the previous switch that we looked at. But now we've got a third terminal, and this is marked up L2. Now we're not going to get too deeply in this video into what those mean and how two-way switching works. For that, please click on the eye in the top corner of the video to take you to another video that will explain how two-way switching works. But at this stage, we just want to be able to recognize that if we turn a switch around and we can see that there's three terminals, each terminal with a connection inside it, that makes this into a two-way switch. So you can see if we go back to the front, we've got a one gang, two-way switch.
So have we changed to a third switch, Joe, or is this the same switch?
Well, from the front again, it looks exactly the same, doesn't it? It looks like the same switch that we looked at previously. But now what we've got, this is a one gang switch. So hopefully that's very clear now. We've got one switch in the middle of the plate, which makes it one gang. But around the back where the magic happens, you can see that we've introduced another change. So now we've gone from having three terminals to having four terminals. Now having four terminals on the back of this one gang switch indicates that this is what we call an intermediate switch. Now again, we're not going to get into lots of depth about how intermediate switching works. For that, please see another video. But actually, just being able to identify that on the back here, we've got four terminals. In this case, we've got two terminals marked L1, two terminals marked L2. That makes this into an intermediate switch. So now what we've got, again, if we turn it around, look at the front, we've got a one gang intermediate switch. So hopefully you can recognize those switches now.
So we've changed switches once again, Joe. Can you explain what we've got in front of us this time?
Yeah, of course. So what we've got here now is we've added switches onto the plate. So we've got two separate switches here. On the left here, we've got a two-gang switch. So now you can see that we've got two switches on the plate. So that's what makes this into a two-gang switch. The gang relates to the number of switches, basically. Here, we've got three switches in the middle of the front plate. So that gives us a three-gang switch. So that's what we're looking at there. Now, it's quite interesting. If we flip this round, Gary, you can see on the back that for both of these switches, we've got three terminals. So I know what you're thinking. Those watching at home, you're thinking, well, they're obviously both two-way switches. And if you recognize that, well done. But you may also be thinking, well, what if I need two gang switches, but each one to be one-way? Well, the answer is you can't actually buy that kind of arrangement without going to some kind of specialized manufacturing system. But the good news is that if you've got a two-way switch, you can use that two-way switch as a one-way switch as well. So it is compatible in that direction. So actually what we've got here is a two-gang two-way switch, but we could, if we wanted to, use one of these or both of these as a one-way switch.
So Joe, thanks for explaining about the light switches to us. I can see we've got a light fitting in front of us. What have we got this time?
Yeah, so what we've got here, Gaz, is we've got what we call a ceiling rose with a pendant attached to it. So the ceiling rose is the base. This is the part that is mounted up on the ceiling. And then the flex hangs down, and that's why we call it a pendant. You'll notice on here, we've got what's called a straight skirt on the base there, which covers over the part where we connect the lamp up. And this would be seen most commonly in domestic installations. Again, viewer, you may have seen this in your own home, in your lounge or your bedroom or somewhere like that. And it's just a very basic light fin. So this bit goes onto the ceiling, this bit dangles down, and you put your lamp in the end there.
So we've changed light fin from the ceiling rose and pendant. What have we got this time, Joe?
So what we've got now is a ceiling rose, but as you can see, what's changed is we've now got a permanently connected lamp holder. So this is no longer hanging down off a flex. This is what we refer to as a batten lamp holder. Another thing you might notice that is quite different about this is this skirt at the top is no longer straight and narrow as it was before. It's flared out slightly, and this is what is referred to, you may hear electricians calling this on site, a home office skirt. You're likely to find this type of fitting anywhere you don't want a pendant hanging down, perhaps where looks aren't that important. You may see these in downstairs toilets, garages, sheds, that kind of thing. And this is what we refer to as a batten lamp holder.
So Joe, we're onto our final lighting point that we'll install in the workshop. So what have we got this time?
So again, you can see a slight difference from before. Once again, we've not got a flex, so this isn't a pendant, but we've lost the ceiling rose. We don't have that large base on the bottom of here where we can make electrical connections. We've got a very small base. So this is a batten lamp holder with a straight skirt. But the difference is that this particular fitting is designed to be mounted through these holes here and here onto a conduit box. And so this would be found in industrial locations, most likely. So what we've got going on here, there's just three connections, two of which go straight through to the front. And there would be a box, a conduit box, that this would mount onto where all the terminations would be connected.
So Joe has run through the lighting accessories that all our learners will be using at Tresham College. It's immensely important that all students can identify and name these accessories, and it's possible that we will be working with them from week two onwards. Let's look at some other electrical accessories we're going to be using in the workshop. So we've moved on from lighting accessories and we're now onto sockets. Joe, can you explain what we've got in front of us this time?
Yeah, absolutely, guys. So now we've got two sockets in front of us here. This one is what we call a one-gang socket. So we've got one socket outlet on the front of the plate. Here we've got a two-gang socket, so we've got two socket outlets on the front of the plate. Another way just to determine what these are is that both of these sockets have got switches on them, which will turn the electricity on and off to the socket outlet. So this is a one-gang switched socket outlet, and this is a two-gang switched socket outlet. So that's how we refer to them technically. If we turn the one-gang switch socket outlet over and have a quick look at the back, you can see on the back here we've got three terminals, and they're marked up in the following way. We've got one terminal marked L, so that's where we terminate our line conductors. We've got another terminal marked N, so that's where we terminate our neutral conductors. And then we've got a terminal marked E, and this terminal is where we connect our CPCs, our circuit protective conductors, which you'll learn a little bit more about in a future video. Looking at the back of the two gang switch socket outlet, you can see we've now got four terminals. Now the reason for that is, once again, we've got one terminal marked L, where we terminate our line conductors, one terminal marked N, where we terminate our neutral conductors, and now we've got two terminals marked E, which is where we're going to terminate our CPCs, or circuit protective conductors. Now the reason we've got two is a little bit complex for this video, but that will be addressed in the future.
So we've moved on to consumer units then, Joe. Can you explain what we've got in front of us this time?
Yeah, absolutely. So this is the most common consumer unit that you'll be fitting during your time here at Tresham College. It's what we call a two-way consumer unit. Now in this instance, the two-way indicates that there is space to fit two circuit breakers in here to go out and feed two different circuits. So that's what we mean by a two-way consumer unit. We've also, just a quick note on cable support. You'll notice in the top of the consumer unit, we've got two glands. This one would be for supporting an outgoing cable to a circuit. This one is to support the incoming cables that feed the consumer unit, and we'll explain why they're important in a future video. And to the left of your picture here, we've got four circuit breakers. You'll notice they are the same brand and they are designed to go inside here. So this is all Crabtree. It's never a good idea to mix and match your circuit breakers in different consumer units. You want them all to be manufactured by the same people. And you can see here we've got the common sizes of circuit breaker that we'll be using while we're here at the college. So we've got here a 6-amp circuit breaker, a 16-amp circuit breaker, 20 amps and 32 amps. So there's lots of other circuit breaker sizes available, but those are the four common ones that you'll use during your time here at the college.
So we've had a look at some of the accessories we're going to be fitting in the workshop. Can you talk us through these boxes for us, Joe, please?
Yeah, absolutely. So these back boxes are very often referred to as Pattresses, so you may hear that while you're out and about on site. And we've got three different sorts here. So again, you'll notice we've got two that are similar outline size but thicker, and one that is twice as big. The reason for that is what we've got here is we've got a back box or a Pattress that is designed to accommodate a switch. Okay, so that just sits on there like that. So on here you could potentially fit a one gang, two gang or three gang switch. Obviously you've got to think about the amount of room you've got in the back there. If you've got a three gang switch, you might struggle to terminate some of the conductors inside there, but that's designed to sit on there. You'll notice it's shallower, so it's a 16 mil depth box there, as opposed to the next size that we're going to look at, which is a 25 mil box. So this box here is 25 mil thick. It's deeper than that box, and that's really designed to accommodate a one gang socket that just sits on there nicely. As you can see, if you try and mount that inside there, you've got zero room in the back for your terminations and your conductors, whereas here you've got a fighting chance of being able to terminate that nice and neatly. So again, one gang boxes of different depths, 16 mil and 25 mil. And then at the back here, we've got a 25 mil box, but this is designed to accommodate a two gang socket like that.
So thanks for that, Joe. Running through the accessories that we're going to be using very early on and hopefully forever, yep, as we move into the electrical industry after our time at Tresham College.
Yeah, absolutely. Any student that comes to learn here at Tresham College can be expecting to install and use these exact accessories that we've been through. Again, we'd like to say thank you very much to Click for their kind donation of loads of accessories that they've given to us. That's a massive help for a poor FE college moving forward. And also we'd like to continue to thank Crabtree for their continued support that they give us regarding their Starbreaker range.
Well, we're going to try and end this properly this time after we all stumble around.
We're going to crush it.
We're hopefully going to crush it. So, we hope this video has been some help.